Riverland, y'all glad to be in the house of the Lord today?
Lamp unto my feet, your way, 'cause the only way for me is a narrow road that leads to life, but I wanna be on. It's a narrow road where the mercy is wide, 'cause you're good on your promise. Come on. I take you at your word. And the chaos fell in line. I know, 'cause I've seen it in my life. It's a narrow road, it's a narrow road that leads to life, but I wanna be on it with everything you have, church.
When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. My God will never fail. I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your
Look, I know it's preseason and people are getting ready for their favorite teams, but we don't have a preseason in the Lord. Amen? I want you to think about, we're gonna put our hands together one more time for the Lord, but I want you to think about what we just sung about. We're going to take God at his word. We have the victory in him. Every battle that you're going through belongs to the Lord. And we already know the outcome because he has the victory. Amen? So we take God at his word, no matter what battle, no matter what situation that we're facing, we know we're going to have the victory in Jesus Christ. Come on, one more time. Put your hands together for the Lord. Amen? Sometimes we got to encourage each other, but sometimes we have to encourage ourselves when we're going through and read the word for ourselves and know the word and what it says, who we are in Christ Jesus. Amen? Amen. We serve a great God. Amen? Great God. Well, good morning. We want to welcome you this morning to Riverland, and we're so glad that you're with us this morning. And we want to put our hands together for those that may be visiting with us for the first time. Those watching online, can we put our hands together for them? Just real quickly, a couple of announcements, and then we're going to get out of the way. This Wednesday night right here at 6:30, we will have our men's meeting, men's gathering this Wednesday at 6:30. And in 2 weeks on the 28th right here, we will have our women's gathering right here Wednesday at 6:30. Immediately after church today, we have our Connect Group Leaders Training a couple of doors down in our kids' suite. So if you're interested in leading a Connect Group and you've never led one before, we have some training available for you right after service today. And speaking of Connect Groups, in 3 weeks we have our fall semester group starting. Can you believe our summer semester, usually when people are gone on vacation, we usually, that's 6 weeks because people are on vacation. Usually that's our slow time with Connect Groups. So you know we had 20 Connect Groups this summer. Awesome, awesome, awesome. So people are getting plugged in. People are getting connected. So 3 weeks, be praying about should you lead a Connect Group. Definitely get involved in a Connect Group. So in 3 weeks, that's taking place. So want to go ahead and pray and get ready for the word. So Father, we just thank you right now for today. God, we thank you for who you are, God, and in turn, who you call each one of us to be, God. So we thank you right now that you can help us just to put away any distractions, Lord, anything that would hinder us from hearing from you this morning, from receiving from you this morning and responding to you, which you would have each one of us to do. So we thank you, Lord, for your word that's about to go forth in our hearts for our community here in Somerville. And we just give you all the glory. We give you all the honor. And we give you all the praise. And may God's people say, amen. Why don't you turn real quickly and greet your neighbor to the left and to the right. Amen.
Well, good morning. Welcome to Riverland. My name is Chris Russo, and I have the privilege of serving as the lead pastor here, and just thankful to be here with you guys today. We're in a series, as you know, called Storyteller, where we're looking at different parables, different stories that Jesus told, and what we can glean from those parables. So I'm just going to kick us off in a word of prayer, and we'll go from there. God, thank you so much for this time. And Lord, I thank you for every single person here. God, thank you that you love every single one of us more than words can possibly express. And Lord, you know everything that everything that we carry. You know us better than we know ourselves. So, Lord, however you want to minister to our hearts, we just give this time to you and thank you that you're able to do immeasurably more than all that we could ever ask or imagine. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen. So today we're going to be looking at a pretty well-known parable. You've probably at least heard parts of it before, the Good Samaritan. And there's a lot going on in kind of a short parable here, but one of the things you have is you've got someone who kind of gets it, whose eyes are open in the parable, and then you've got some guys who have some blinders on and unfortunately miss what's most important. And as I was thinking about that, I was like, there's definitely been a lot of times in my life where I've had blinders on and missed what was most important, even when it was right in front of me. There's some serious ways I've done that and some silly ways. And I remember this is one of the silly ways. So I remember it was right after Abby and I got married, and we had bought a house, and my brother-in-law and sister-in-law were staying with us. And it had been one of those like long days, and all I was looking forward to was getting home and getting some of my favorite ice cream. I had my favorite ice cream, so I like peanut butter like everything. I eat way too much peanut butter and jelly, but I like my favorite ice cream is Ben and Jerry's peanut butter cup ice cream. Anyone ever had that? that for me is like the jam. I don't have it a lot, but when I do, that's no one touches it in the house. And I remember that day in particular. It was a tough day, and I was looking forward to getting some. And my brother and sister-in-law were staying with us, and so I got home and I went to the freezer and I got the little pint of ice cream out. There was just a little bit left, but just enough, you know. And I opened it up though, and it was just filled with ice. And I was like, I'm not a big science person, so I'm like, how could the freezer have turned this into ice? I had no idea what had happened. And Abby, actually, my wonderful sweet wife, actually knew what had happened. That my brother-in-law Nate, prior to going to bed, had eaten my ice cream and had replaced it with water, and hence the ice. And I was like, I was so mad, y'all. It was like, like I said, it had been a tough day, and that is all I was looking forward to, was getting that ice cream. And I've never been like a big prankster, but I was really angry. So I went to bed mad, and at that point, I wasn't thinking about getting him back, but I remember I woke up, and first thing in the morning, it was like an epiphany. It was like, it just hit me, the perfect way to get him back. Nate loves his Starbucks coffee first thing in the morning. So I was like, I know what I'm going to do. And so I went to the creamer, and I poured it all into a jar, and then I took some Pepsi and replaced the creamer with Pepsi, and I knew this was going to be perfect. So Nate like got his, like, he's going through his morning routine, and he gets his perfect Starbucks coffee ready, and he goes to grab the creamer and dumps Pepsi into his coffee. And I'm not going to repeat what he said to me, but he was mad all morning. We wanted to like hang with them through the day, and he's like, I think we're just going to go. And I'm pretty sure he's forgiven me now. It's been over 10 years, but still, it was one of those. I still think it was pretty funny, but it was one of those instances where perhaps I got a little too serious about my ice cream and let what was most important, the family relationship, get in the way, or let the, you know what I'm saying? Well, I'll let the ice cream get in the way of the family relationship. But when I really think back on growing up, I didn't grow up in a Christian home or anything, and was not, for the first part of my life, was not focused on God at all, was really just focused on what I could consume from the world. There were so many times, so many instances when I let what was most important get by me because I had blinders on. And I'm sure that all of us in some way, shape, or form can relate to that. You know, that's, if we're going to make the most out of the life that God has given us, so much of it is our is our ability to see. Jesus would frequently say, let him who has eyes, he would talk about people having eyes to see, ears to hear, and hearts that understand. And how crucial that is that we see that we see the king, how crucial it is for us to have open hearts and open minds so that we can actually see the kingdom of God, see the divine opportunities that are in front of us every day. So with that in mind, I want to look at this parable, and we're going to see some different characters in the parable and probably be able to relate to different ones. So we're going to be looking at Luke 10, 25 through 37. And it says this, on one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. Teacher, he asked, what must I do to inherit eternal life? What is written in the law, he replied, how do you read it? He answered, love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. You have answered correctly, Jesus replied. Do this, and you will live. But he wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? And here's the parable. In reply, Jesus said, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho. And I don't know if you guys do this, but sometimes for me, even though I've been to Israel, there's still a part of me that sometimes reads some of these stories like it's like magical Bible land. So these are obviously real places. Jerusalem was, if this helps you imagine it a little bit, Jerusalem and Jericho were actually about 18 miles apart, and Jerusalem is 2,500 feet above sea level, and Jericho was 825 feet below sea level. So a relatively short geographical difference, but you know, this is a treacherous road. So a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road. When he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, and if you don't know who the Samaritans were, they were a despised people group. So in 721 BC, the northern kingdom of Israel fell to the Assyrians, and many of the people of Israel were led off to Assyria as captives, but some remained in the land and intermarried with foreigners planted there by the Assyrians. So these guys were half Jewish, half Gentile, and they were not looked favorably upon by the Jews. So the parable goes, but a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii. So a denarius was a daily wage. If we work off of an average income of $50,000, that's like $190 per workday. So about $400 is what we could liken that to. So 2 denarii, about $400. So the next day he took out 2 denarii, $400, and gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said, and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have. Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? The expert in the law replied, the one who had mercy on him. Jesus told him, go and do likewise. So a lot going on here. Obviously, it was a big deal that Jesus made the hero of the story a Samaritan, someone who was looked down on. So that's something that we definitely need to take note of. And then these two religious leaders had the blinders on, right? They had this opportunity to take care of this man, and they passed by on the other side. And one of the reasons may be that in Jewish culture, contact with a dead body was understood to be defiling. So the priests may have assumed the guy was dead, and to avoid uncleanness, that may have been the reason why they passed by on the other side. But we're not 100% sure. Obviously, it's a parable, so Jesus isn't talking about necessarily a real life circumstance. But whatever the case may be, the two that would have been expected to do the right thing in this story didn't, and the one who would have been expected to do the wrong thing did the right thing. So there's a lot going on here, but I think there are some key truths that we can learn from it. So the first one is that love can be interrupted. Love can be interrupted. You know, when you look through Jesus' ministry, if you just read through the four Gospels, one thing that is amazing to me is with a man who had so much to accomplish, you don't see this frenetic, crazy person running around Jerusalem and Galilee saying, I've got a revolution to start. You don't see somebody who's just kind of going around like a crazy person trying to get things done. He actually allowed himself to be interrupted. He would be on his way to help someone, and you would frequently see someone intersect his path, and he would stop what he was doing and take care of whatever need it was. It's amazing to see. So the Samaritan in this case allowed himself to be interrupted. I don't know, the parable doesn't say what business he was on, but I doubt he was just taking a stroll, especially given the difficulty of traveling this road. But he allowed himself to be interrupted. And that definitely speaks to me because anyone hate being interrupted? I hate being interrupted when I'm talking. I hate being interrupted when I'm in the middle of something. I definitely have the ability to focus. And when I focus, it's really silly, actually. I'll be like, there have been times where this is a safe place. I can confess here. There'll be times where I'm even reading the Bible or having a quiet time and someone interrupts me in the house and I'm like, and I bark at him like, I'm trying to spend time with Jesus. Y'all are probably not the best example for my sons in that. But even before coming here, I just, in my head, I mean, when I think about some of the most amazing times that God has worked in my life, they've been through in what felt like at the time interruptions. I mean, even before coming to Riverland, I just knew, and I could point to the moment where I felt like I knew that God wanted me to plant a church in downtown Charleston. I mean, I was certain of it. I immediately went to go seek wise counsel, and every person I sat with to tell them that I was going to plant a church in downtown Charleston for a litany of reasons, people thought I was absolutely nuts. They're like, it's not going to work. Nobody actually lives downtown. People just commute. Like, there's too many. There's no parking downtown. Real estate's crazy expensive downtown. And I would just sit with person after person, and I would smile and nod, and I'd be like, okay, I'm still doing it. Yep, still doing it. And then my wife was not feeling it at all, which should have been a major red flag to me. But I was still like, yeah, I think she's just not hearing from God. She's not as close to him as I am. So, yeah, not a good husband move there. But I was just like, I was dead set that that's what needed to happen. And through God's gracious interruption, my path intersected with Pastor Jeff, who was the previous pastor at Riverland. And praise God, I'm here and not downtown, because clearly that was not where God was leading me, but I was just, I don't know, whatever. I thought that was what I was supposed to do. But love can be interrupted. Jesus demonstrated that, and in this parable, that's one of the things I see. This Samaritan was on some kind of business and had something going on. He was traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho for some reason, and he saw this hurt, beaten person as, I don't want to read too much into it, but he saw out of love, out of compassion, for whatever reason, he saw what the others didn't see. They saw what may have been an inconvenience or the possibility of being unclean. But Jesus even explained that all the law and the prophets, even if they were trying to be obedient, even if the priest and the Levite were trying to be obedient to the law, Jesus explained that of the 613 commands in the Old Testament, that the two greatest commands were love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. That those were the weightier or the weightiest issues of the law. And so this Samaritan saw that. And so love can be interrupted. And I think for me, that I think especially in our busy culture, we need to be reminded of that. You know, that can be a prayer when we're going to church. That can be a prayer as we go through our daily lives. Like, God, would you help me to notice you during the day? Would you help me to see people the way that you see them? if there's a conversation I'm supposed to have today, help me to not be too busy to miss it. If there's somebody I'm supposed to text or a coffee I'm supposed to have, help me to not be so caught up in my own agenda that I would just miss it. Because chances are, that'd be a great way to start the day. Because chances are there's going to be opportunities for you during the day to intersect with God by serving someone or whatever the case may be. And if you're not careful, you might miss it. You might miss it, especially if you're just focused on your agenda and decide that all interruptions must be, must be just that, interruptions. So love can be interrupted. Number two, love is costly. One thing that sticks out to me from this is this guy, if 2 denarii is equivalent to $400 today, he had some financial margin, but he also had extra time and energy. And there's a quote that I heard recently that really spoke to me. It's this. It says that it's not what you gather, but what you scatter that tells the kind of life you have lived. It's not what you gather, but what you scatter that tells the kind of life you have lived. It's the quote's by Golda Meir, if I'm saying that right. And she was a prime minister of Israel. And I just thought, so I won't go too much into it, but I had, Abby and I lost a friend this week. So when I was the campus pastor of Seacoast West Ashley for about 5 years, this wonderful couple would watch our kids for free, which our kids are not always easy. And so it was an incredible act of kindness because they wanted Abby and I to be able to go on date night. So they would come and they would watch our kids for free, Tim and Donna. They were incredible. They served in kids ministry every single weekend. And they have a grown daughter who doesn't live here. And just one of those couples that just exude the presence of Christ. And it was amazing. You really got to pay attention when you're at memorial services, because I think it's a great time sometimes to learn about what really matters in life and what really doesn't. I mean, her service really kind of preached itself, because Donna lived the kind of life that this quote is talking about. It's not what you gather, but what you scatter that tells the kind of life you've lived. And people got up and testified time and time again as to how Donna lived her life for others, in service of others. I could go on with some of the different things that she did, but that's the kind of life she lived. So, love is costly. It's costly when it comes to, what it takes is it takes margin. It takes, when we look at the Samaritan here, I don't want to read more into it than what's there, but had some financial margin. That doesn't happen by accident. We've got to, do we have margin in our finances? And this isn't intended to be condemning or anything, but do we have margin in our finances that if somebody was in need, we could help them? That's a question that I think is worth asking from this. He also had some margin when it came to his time and energy. Again, it's a parable, so we don't want to read too much into it, but he had extra time. He may not have had, if we look at his life, he may not have had extra time and energy, but he certainly was rerouted whatever it was he was currently doing to take care of this person. So have we established our values in such a way? Have we decided that fundamentally our lives are about serving Jesus and serving his people, that when we encounter these divine opportunities, we're not going to see them fundamentally as interruptions? We'll see them for what they are. And I think that goes to, again, I like boiling it down to a prayer. So if love is costly when it comes to our time, our resources, our energy, a prayer for that would be like, God, would you help me to set aside resources? Would you help me to prepare in advance for these kinds of divine opportunities? Help me to see them And then help me to have, you know, with the way that my schedule is structured, help me to have whatever margin I need so that when these divine opportunities come, that I'm actually ready to make the necessary investments. Because y'all, I mean, I've talked about this before, but I love the quote by Francis Chan where he said our biggest concern shouldn't be of fail, or shouldn't our biggest concern shouldn't be failure, but at succeeding at things that don't really matter. I love that quote. Our biggest concern shouldn't be failure, but it should be what if we succeed at things that don't really matter. And I love that. And it kind of brings me to the third point. Love makes an eternal difference in the lives of others. Love makes an eternal difference in the lives of others. So in Matthew 6, 19 through 21, Jesus said, "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moths and vermin destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where moths and vermin do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." And then C.S. Lewis, kind of breaking that down, similar idea, said, "Aim at heaven and you will get earth thrown in. Aim at earth and you get neither." I mean, this one thing that sticks out to me, another thing that sticks out to me from this parable is I doubt that this Samaritan just took a walk that day and just happened to be ready to take care of the need that was in front of him. If we're going to see divine opportunities and actually do the right thing in those moments, it takes preparation. You know, the way that we're going to see the divine opportunities is through a daily commitment of spending time with God and his word, by spending time in prayer with him, by spending time with other believers. As we do that, our minds and hearts are transformed in such a way so that we can actually see the divine opportunities when they come. If we don't live intentionally, if we don't prepare ourselves for those moments, they're going to pass us by. We're not going to see them because our values, nobody drifts uphill, right? So if we're not intentional, our paradigms, our values, the way that we see is going to be so worldly that we're going to see the divine opportunities in front of us as interruptions. We're going to see the half dead man by the side of the road, and we're going to make some kind of excuse. There's going to be some kind of reason as to why we shouldn't cross the road. The only way that we're actually going to be able to see and capitalize on these divine opportunities and actually serve in the ways that God's designed us to serve is if we spend regular time preparing for those moments. Again, we get to spend time in God's word. We get to go into God's presence and pray. We get to spend time with other believers in the body of Christ. And as we do that, our souls are formed and shaped in such a way that when those divine opportunities arise, we don't see them as interruptions. We get to serve our wife. We get to serve our husband. We get to serve our kids. We get to pray for others. We get to spend our time doing our King's business. We get to participate in the advancement of the kingdom of God. It's only as we, and so it takes preparation. You don't, that Samaritan, I venture to say that Samaritan didn't just wake up and just accidentally stumble. He was ready for that moment. He didn't just accidentally stumble into it. He was ready for it. And if we're going to, I love Ephesians 2, 8 through 10. It says, "For we're saved by grace through faith. This not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, not by works so that no one can boast. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." That means whether you realize it or not, when you woke up this morning, there were good works prepared in advance for you to walk in. There were good works and there still are today. You have moments prepared for you from eternity past, prepared for you today, for you to walk into. The question is, will you see them? And when you see them, will you cross the road? Will you cross the road? Or will you see it as an interruption? Will you see it as, I don't know, something that you don't need to spend time with. It's an important question. You know, one thing I love about this parable is it points so clearly to the gospel. The real good Samaritan is Jesus. I mean, when you think about it, another pastor had kind of, I used to just read this parable and I would think, okay, I need to be kind to my neighbors. But another pastor helped me see that the real good Samaritan, the good Samaritan points to Jesus, who didn't just cross the road, but saw us when we were half dead, completely incapable of helping ourselves, left heaven, came to earth, humbled himself to be born as a baby, lived in this broken world, was misunderstood, was rejected by people, was betrayed, was mocked, was tortured and crucified, and then rose from the dead 3 days later because he didn't want to do eternity without you and without me. He's the real Good Samaritan. So I don't know who you relate most to in the parable, but probably all of us could relate to, I would imagine that all of us in some way, shape, or form could relate to everyone in the parable. All of us have at some point been the priest or the Levite that for whatever reason we had blinders on and we zoomed right past divine opportunities. I mean, it happens every day. There have been so many times where I've had opportunities to serve my wife and my kids that I've zoomed right past. There have been so many times that I've seen somebody that God had strategically placed in my life for me to care for as an interruption, as somebody that just, I've been the priest and the Levite, no question about it. I also, you know, by the grace of God, I know there have been some times that I've been the Good Samaritan where I've actually crossed the road but the reason that I've been able to cross the road sometimes and actually take care of somebody is because I relate mostly with the half-dead man. I relate mostly with being in a place, whether it's when I got saved when I was 18 or so many moments along my journey, that I've been in a place where as a new dad, as a new husband, as a new pastor, in a million different instances where I was in a situation that there's no way I could have helped myself, that there's no way I could have pulled off what I needed to pull off, there's no way that I could have done what I needed to do, and Jesus again and again crosses the road and through someone else or through circumstances or whatever means has helped me and met me where I'm at and restored me and set my feet on solid ground so that I could serve him. And so I think we could probably all relate to each person in this parable, but I'd love for you guys to bow your heads. And if you relate, as I often do, to the half-dead man in the sense that there's some area of your life or there's something going on in your life right now that you're just, if God doesn't show up in it, nothing's going to change. If you relate to him, to the half-dead man at all, would you just slip up a hand? Yeah, I know a lot of us. Well, I want to take a minute to pray for those who lifted up their hands, and really for all of us. God, I thank you so much, Lord, that you left heaven, came to earth. None of us really understand what that took. None of us really understand what it took for you to bear the sin of the whole world, to die on the cross, to be rejected by your Father, and to rise from the dead so that we could have hope, so that we could have salvation, because you loved us that much. None of us really understand that. We understand only bits and pieces. But God, I just pray for everyone who lifted up their hand. God, there are so many areas that if you don't show up in them, there's nothing that's going to change. And so I pray for everybody who lifted up their hand that you would meet them exactly where they're at and that they would know what your word says, that you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. And the same, and that if you came through for us while we were your enemies, how much more so now that we've been reconciled to you, will you show up for us now that we're your sons and daughters? God, I pray for each person who lifted up their hand, whether the need be financial, relational, circumstantial, whatever it is, God, I pray that you would meet them where they're at and give them your peace that passes all understanding. And I pray for all of us, God. All of us can have blinders on. All of us miss it sometimes. And I just pray that in this time of response, that you would convict our hearts and that you would show us how to become more like you. Show us how to become more like you, Lord. It's so easy for pride and all kinds of stuff to creep up in us and for us to think we have no room to grow. We've already arrived. This teaching's for someone else, whatever, whatever. But God, I pray that we would all have humble hearts and that you would speak to us and show us what responding to you looks like. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, guys, as we move into this time, the worship team is going to lead us. And as they do, this is what we call response time. They're going to lead us in a song, and we'll have a couple people up front, myself included, willing to pray for you. You know, maybe you want to come and just receive prayer. You don't have to say your name or the situation. We'd be happy to pray for you, just believing that God has more for you and wants to move in your life. There'll also be some people serving communion. And, you know, you don't have to be a member of this church, just a member of the body of Christ. And as you come and take communion, remember that Jesus is the Good Samaritan, that he's the one that without him, there's no way that we would have any life, we would have no hope, we would have no future, we would have nothing apart from him. And just remember that as you reflect on his broken body and his shed blood, what he did for us, what he did for all of us. And then, the next step for you may just be just quietly praying in your seat. Whatever it looks like, let's respond to God together.
up in here. Let's just sing that chorus one more time, just the instruments here.
I run to the Father, fall into grace, turn with the hiding, reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend, so I run to the Father again.
Sing it again, church.
Run to the
Amen. What a sweet time right there. Amen. Can we put our hands together for our Father? Amen. Amen. Can we put our hands at Pastor Chris and the awesome word? Amen. Amen. Awesome word. And we pray that you got and receive what you're supposed to get from that word today. And speaking of that, on the back of your chairs, there are some connection cards there. And if you have any kind of need, any prayer requests, we pray over those cards, over your requests every week. So you can scan that QR code and we will receive your prayer requests. And I promise you, we pray over those prayer requests every week. And speaking of QR codes, we have multiple ways to give. You can scan that QR code. We have giving boxes, you can text online. We just continue to be amazed and thank God for the generosity of his people in giving in times like this. People still have giving hearts. So put your hands together for yourselves, for just continue to have giving hearts and obedient hearts to give. So I want to leave you with our benediction. It comes out of Numbers chapter 6, verses 24 through 26. And it says, may the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord smile on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord show you his favor and give you his peace. God bless you. We hope you have an awesome, awesome, blessed week this week. God bless you.